So hi, everyone. I'm Elizabeth. I'm the founder and I'm the owner of Extraordinary Journeys, co-founder with Marcia Gordon, who's on the call as well tonight. And I'm just so glad you could all make it tonight to talk about travel during the pandemic. And, you know, I just get so many emails. I thought it would just be really fun and interesting to share what it was like to travel during the pandemic and answer as many questions instead of just doing it individually. I thought it would be fun to just do it as one big event. Before I get started, I just want to make sure that, and I think everyone is because we did as a default, but if everyone could put themselves except the speakers on mute and even turn off your videos, it'll just help with making sure everyone can hear us. So this is the format that I was thinking that I'm going to do tonight. I'm going to kind of start with a little introduction, and then I'll introduce our guest speakers, our guest travelers tonight, who kindly agreed to join us and talk about their experiences on the ground. And then we'll have a little Q&A. A few of you have sent me, I got quite a few questions, and I kind of organized them by themes. But if anyone has questions as we go along, feel free to put them in the chat and we'll answer them at the end of the presentation. So these last 2 years have definitely been crazy. I still remember March 2020, and I just remember borders shutting down, which I never thought could happen. And it started with South America, and we just knew that it was going to happen in Africa. And we had a lot of people on the ground at the time, and it was extremely stressful. And I still remember trying to get through to the airlines. We were all scrambling to get through. No one could talk to airlines and figure out what was going on. And I remember this couple in Botswana, it was their honeymoon. They had no idea what was going on. They'd been on safari, and here I am. They get a call from me, and I'm like, please say yes to Emirates. You're going home tomorrow. And they're going, no, we're going to Mauritius. And I'm like, if you get on that flight to Mauritius, you are spending the rest of the pandemic in Mauritius. You got to turn around. And sure enough, thankfully, they listened to us. They got on their flight. They got home. And the very next day, Mauritius shut their border. So these were the stories, and these were the conversations we're having. And no one got stuck. We got everyone home, but that was the first time where I just remember my legs shaking. I was so stressed. And then it was kind of 3 months of trying to rebook everyone, negotiate with suppliers, because of course everyone was just telling me, this is nothing, it's like Ebola, like get over it, like don't do anything. And I'm like, no, this is serious. This is gonna last for a while. So it was just a lot of it was just fighting and just like talking to all our hotels and suppliers and telling them, you gotta listen to us, we gotta find a solution. July comes along and our first travelers say, we wanna go, we're traveling. I'm like, what, you're ready to travel? What, we've been shut down. These are like from New York, they've gone through the worst. I'm like, you're ready to travel. We're not ready to send you. We have no idea how to do this. We have no idea what it's like on the ground. This doesn't seem like a good idea, but they were determined. And I'm glad they did, because it really kind of like opened, got us comfortable with people who were willing to go. But the biggest challenge at the time, honestly, is we didn't even know what a PCR test was. We didn't even know where to get them. We thought an antigen test was the same as a PCR test. I mean, we had no idea at the time. Thankfully, they were in New York, so we were able to get them a PCR test. But we ended up having to partner with like mail-in COVID labs, because some people lived in places where there were no COVID tests that we couldn't even get them in time. We had to get them in 72 hours. And at the time, PCR tests would take sometimes 4 to 5 days to get results. So there were many times where we had clients like barely get the results an hour before their flights. But that again, no one missed their flights. But just when I look back, I'm like, I can't believe no one missed a flight and everyone got their COVID test in time. So those were our first travelers. And I think they were well rewarded. They were one, I believe, of like 10 vehicles in the crater, Ngorongoro crater in Tanzania. Mm-hmm. And to give you a sense, pre-pandemic, there are up to 400 vehicles in the crater. So imagine being one of 10, there were probably like 10 people in the whole Tanzania at the time, and they got to travel. So it was definitely a trip of a lifetime for them. And as I said, that was kind of the beginning for us of feeling comfortable that people could travel and that our own team could start traveling. And so already a lot of our team is here today. I think it started with Lara and Jenny, who went to Tanzania as well. Tanzania was a little easier at the time to get into, so they traveled. And then from then on, you know, everyone kind of, anyone who felt comfortable could go. But it did, it still was difficult, you know. First time Europe put their travel restrictions, didn't tell us anything. KLM didn't say anything. And somehow I read this little notification. The clients didn't know. And it said, you will now need a COVID test to go home and to get on the flight. So we're scrambling to get these technicians and the Masai Mara. These people are leaving the next day and we need to get these PCR tests. And we literally remember flying the first lab technicians and being like, you're going to find these people. They're in the Masai Mara. They need to leave tomorrow. Please get them a COVID test. I mean, it just seemed impossible. Now it seems so easy to us, but at the time it was almost like, it felt like we were moving mountains. Other funny moments that, you know, I mean, not moments, not funny at the time, but in hindsight, pretty funny, were the alcohol bans. Suddenly there were a lot of alcohol bans in South Africa and Botswana. And I mean, it came to the point with one family, I asked them to put vodka in water bottles if they wanted sundowners. And I was like, you are going to be a high school student and you're going to just sneak that alcohol. And they did it and they had their sundowners. So that was kind of like a funny moment, but not, you know, it was a little bit stressful at the time. But all I can say is through all of this, all these changes, everything that we were going through, I was just so thankful that my team was there, and I cannot say how hard they worked at like trying to know all the different requirements clients were going to have, changing their flights. Suddenly flights were like, oh, it's based on four people traveling. There were so many cancellations. But all in all, this is what's amazing. We had 750 people travel, between July 2020 and December 2021. And all of that, what's even more amazing is that whole time we had one false positive, and one day I'll tell that story. They tested negative afterwards, and they were able to travel, but we never had anyone test positive for COVID. We had a few people test positive for COVID before their trips, but no one doing until Omicron hit. And then Christmas was the first time we really had to deal. And it wasn't even that bad. We had one positive COVID test in Rwanda. And again, we were the first company to be able to move our clients from a government regulated hotel to a luxury hotel to ride out the quarantine. I had to get the tourism board on the call, on the phone, and beg them and get a medical lab to go and let us do it, but we did it. And then we had two people test positive in Ecuador, and they had to quarantine there. So other than that, those were the only cases we had. And then otherwise, as I said, what we did really well is everyone on the team wanted to travel. You know, no one had to, but if they wanted to, they could travel. But that also allowed us to get a lot of firsthand experience, know what it was like. So if people did want to go, we could help them and guide them. We can talk about our experiences. And I think that was, you know, that was very important for us to be able to help people during these times. I would like to point out the award of the person who traveled the most during COVID in our team goes to our content manager, Alicia. She actually traveled to 8 different countries during COVID. Those included Brazil, which seems crazy to me at the time now. I mean, you went to Rwanda, you went to Botswana. I mean, you went, and knowing that Alicia does live in Canada, which if some of you know, Canada was quite strict.
Very strict.
So just for fun, Alicia put together a little video of the team just showing all the travel we did get to do during COVID. So if you wanna go ahead, Alicia.
Well, pick me up with golden hand. Oh, let's sail. Well, I would like to hold my little hand.
song for Mother.
Send me away. Send me my way. Send me on 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 my way. But it's pretty young.
So yeah, so that was hopefully I'm gonna take back Alicia. I'm gonna try to take back the screen, but that was hopefully you just that just kind of give you a sense of what it was like a little bit and all the places we went to. So quickly, and I'll kind of wrap this up really quickly, some of the things we did to help with all these changing regulations, I mean, honestly, we spent hours trying to understand what the rules were, being on top of them. They were changing by the minute. We had teams, we were talking to our competitors in the industry to know what they knew. Rachel in our office, some of you have worked with her, she literally became, and I don't know if she's here tonight, she will be talking later because there are a lot of travel insurance questions. She became a travel insurance specialist, knowing more than some of the travel insurance agents. We had to find a new, like a air desk. We got together with a lot of people in the safari world for people who could make sure we can help with tickets. And we had contacts on the ground with all the airlines. We hired back Sumendri, our concierge, full-time on the ground because she had to assist with a lot of canceled flights, with rebooking, making sure that people were getting their COVID tests, that all those details were taken care of. And Sumendri was a great help on the ground. And some of you who traveled with us dealt with her. And honestly, it really just was a team effort. Like everyone, I say that now and it looks like it was so easy in some ways, but there were times we were so discouraged, we were so tired, we're like, this will never end. But we got through there, we negotiated prices, we went back to our suppliers and we tried to make it work for everyone. And it was quite a battle, but I'm very proud of the team and I'm really glad that we are able to make this work. So I definitely see a light at the end of the tunnel. It's not over. Every day is a new challenge, but we are definitely going in the right direction. And, you know, I'll talk about more in our Q&A later, but just like all the COVID testing was wrapping up, now they're wrapping down. So every day it's keeping up with the new country that's allowing us to travel without a PCR test. The big one was South Africa, which was huge because if you're traveling to Southern Africa, you are traveling via South Africa. So until South Africa got their COVID tests out of the way, it was making it very difficult. So now we're just waiting for Zimbabwe. They're one of the last holdouts in Southern Africa. We're hoping for an announcement anytime. Already we have 1,000 people set to travel this year. So, you know, just this year alone, we're kind of coming all back and all this summer. So with that, I invited Nancy and her sister Ellen, who are here tonight. You can wave your hands and you're out there. There's Nancy. Don't see Ellen.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. And then Amber and
I can't get it anymore.
Oops, if someone's on.
We're discontinued. No.
Oops, I'm gonna mute.
I have to get a Sunday.
Okay. And we've got Amber and Alan out there who also traveled with us. So Ellen and Nancy, to give you some background, Ellen and Nancy are on the East Coast. Nancy's in DC, I'm in DC as well. Ellen's in New York. They have been loyal travelers since 2016, going on a trip almost every year. They've been pretty much everywhere. I mean, they might as well work for Extraordinary Journeys at this point because they have been to Tanzania, they've been to South Africa, Botswana, Rwanda, Zambia, Zimbabwe, they've been to Chile with us. So what I love is that they really got to see what it was like before the pandemic, and then they decided to go to Zambia and Botswana in October this year. So it'll be kind of interesting to hear their perspective. And Alan and Amber tonight, I'm really glad they could join us as well. You came to us during the pandemic. We'd actually never planned a trip with you before, and they planned two trips with us. And I think you have a very interesting perspective because you went to South Africa. And you had to actually move your trip, and we'll kind of go into it later why. But you also went to Chile. So it's kind of interesting if anyone has questions of what it was like to travel in Africa versus traveling to South America. So, and Alan and Amber are based in Arizona. So that is why they have the sunlight, that glow on their face versus East Coast people right now who are in the dark. let's start with traveling. You know, why traveling during the pandemic? You know, when did you decide you were ready and you were going to do these trips? You know, let me start with like Nancy and Ellen.
Well, I think probably 3 months into the pandemic, we were like, we have got to get something scheduled because we're going to go crazy if we don't have something to look forward to. And so we started talking with you guys about putting and figuring out when do we think maybe, because, you know, when we went into this, we thought, okay, it's going to be a 3 month pandemic and then we're all going to be back to normal. And then it became apparent that that was not going to be the case. And so we planned our trip for October of 2021. So literally it was
planning in June of 2020.
So it was, 15 months ahead of time.
So you and you were vaccinated by then. So I think you didn't know that at the time.
We didn't know we would be vaccinated then. I don't think the vaccines were a thing at that point in time.
Mm-mm. So you were just stir crazy. You just needed something to look forward to. How about you, Alan and Amber?
Ours is pretty much the exact same, actually. I was getting very antsy 1 month in, I think like by April, and we had already had multiple trips canceled. Five trips canceled that we had planned on our own, that were supposed to happen spring, summer 2020. So I was the same way. I wanted something to look forward to. And we reached out specifically to Extraordinary Journeys because we had friends that had gone to Africa on their honeymoon and had a great experience. So that's kind of where EJ came into my head. And I reached out and was basically told that you guys would be willing to plan something as long as I knew that it might be postponed. Yeah. But we knew that although we wouldn't get a refund, that we would be able to reschedule. And that was enough for me because just knowing that it would happen at some point was enough for me to make it.
Yeah, we didn't expect it to actually happen, you know, when we had reached out to you all, but knowing that eventually it will was enough for us to look forward to.
Yeah, originally, I think I reached out in May of 2020, and we scheduled it initially for September of 2020, thinking the pandemic would only last, like they said, 3 months or something. I thought that. He didn't. He never thought we would go in September.
And then South Africa didn't even open up by September. Right. So
then we had to reschedule for January, and then we might get more into that later. But then in January, they were about to shut down again. And the alcohol ban went into effect a few days before our trip. And so we made the decision to postpone it again. And we ended up going in May 2021. Mm-hmm.
So you had to postpone it twice. So and at the time, everyone was actually accommodating and did. And I'll answer some of those questions later because I think that is changing a little bit. But at the time, everyone was like, if people want to postpone, we will work with you. And that we felt very sure of when we were doing those trips. So you decide, it's funny, we had another couple just at that time, they decided to still travel to South Africa during the alcohol ban. And it was like a speakeasy. Everyone was like putting it in like coffee cups and like sneaking it in. So I talked about the plastic bottles, but that also happened in South Africa. And, you know, they all ended up getting their alcohol, but going wine tasting during that time was a little bit interesting. So are you glad at the end that you did make that decision, and what was it like on the ground? Was it what you expected? Like, how were you ready for it, and how was it?
Do you want us to start?
Yeah, let's start, and then I'll get Nancy and Ellen to share their thoughts.
Yeah, I mean, I think we knew when we left, I had an idea what it was going to be like, because we had heard that there was not many tourists at all in South Africa. And so when we got there, I mean, the flight on the way there was indicative of that. The planes were, you know, like not full. And when we landed, the airport was busy-ish for COVID times. But once we started going to places like in Joburg, we stopped there first. It became apparent that, you know, we were going to be pretty much the only ones out doing stuff.
Oh, really?
But it was nice because it was just us. And we had, you know, the whole city and the whole country essentially to ourselves.
Were they wearing masks at the time? Like, did you feel safe, like at the airports and everything?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
It was required.
It was required, and actually, like
surgical masks.
Yeah, and especially like, for example, if you try to go into like the mall towards the end, every individual store you went to, you had to get temperature checked and sign your name and state that you were here and you didn't have any symptoms and stuff.
And
every
your phone store. Number, so yeah, they could track you.
Yeah. So we felt really safe at all times.
How about you? Ellen and Nancy, you also went through Johannesburg Airport for your flight. Like, what was your experience like?
Yeah, on the way out, we went through Joburg. We flew into Lusaka. For me, having been, I spent the pandemic in New York City. So it was liberating just to get out. You know, I spent a lot of time at home. And it was really nice to be out. And I felt very safe. I felt everyone was wearing masks. When we got vaccinated and boosted before we went. So that was, you know, that was a plus. And it was before the Omicron. So I felt very safe and very protected, and everyone was wearing masks. And it was incredible.
We were so gleeful to get on the plane. I've never been so excited to have like 24 hours in an airplane with a mask on. And it didn't bother us. It was easy. Getting through the airport in Lusaka was easy. You guys always have somebody to take us through and take us to the hotel, which was awesome. And people wore masks, you know, in the public spaces. It was, I never felt threatened.
And there was never a crowd anywhere.
Well, I was going to ask you, having been to Africa so many times before the pandemic, and actually you traveled, I was just noted. Yeah, I remember you traveled. Your last trip was actually January. You came back 28th, 2020.
Yeah.
You went to Kenya and Rwanda. That was before you knew this would all shut down. So
it was starting, but we had no clue that it would shut down. We were, you know, people were wearing masks. Some people were wearing masks in the
Amsterdam
airport on our way back. And it didn't even dawn on us. So
how was the experience between, you know, from your, how did it, you know, how did it feel compared to your past trips?
Only slightly different, because people would talk about being vaccinated and we would always wear our masks on the way to a camp. And it, you know, there were four of us traveling together. So it was just us and the guide. So, you know, we didn't have to wear the masks while we were on safari on our drives. And so it was almost normal. The only thing that wasn't normal to me, sorry, was that the camps were, I mean, the first camp we went to in South Luangwa was empty. We were the only people there. And it sort of just took my breath away that these poor people that you know need us to go. I mean, you know, that for to keep their camps open, and also for the conservation and all the money that goes towards conservation through what we pay in going there. So, you know, it just impressed me that it was more important to be there when we were there in October than ever before.
Yeah, it's interesting that you talk about that, because that was one of the biggest challenges is when everything shut down. I remember we were doing a lot of fundraisers and, you know, we were very nervous about poaching. You know, so many of the conservation projects in Africa are so linked to tourism. Mm-hmm. So it was hard because, you know, even when, you know, people were like, oh, we don't want to postpone, we want our money back, which I totally understand. But it was also so hard to, you know, to explain how in Africa this conservation, like by canceling, like these are projects in future of our conservation that was going to be affected. And it's not an easy conversation to have with people, because I also understand the point of view, you know, we didn't get to travel, we want everything back. But by doing that, I think it also saved and allowed kind of the long run, because I'd say overall everyone is coming out of it okay. There was a lot of like donors and people gave to conservation to help through it, but these are really hard times, because as you mentioned, a lot of these people who work in the camps, you know, they're paying for their whole families out there. These guides, like that is their income. And a lot of the people who are saying to travel are like, you're going to want to tip even more while you're on the ground, because like your heart goes out to everyone. So it was just kind of an interesting moment. And I kept on being like, should I be sending people to Africa during COVID or not? You know, these are hard conversations, and I wasn't sure what the right decision was. And we were kind of like, yeah, but you know, people also need incomes and people do need us to travel. So it was not easy. You know, some people may fight me on this. I don't know. I mean, clearly there are conversations about this that can go on forever.
Yeah, I think it drove it home though, being there. I mean, the people are, for those of you who have been, I'm sure you know, that they're so warm and welcoming, and they want to share everything they have and know with you. And it's just heightened by the fact that there hadn't been people there in a very long time, or a lot of people there in a very long time. And the camps were not full. So Ellen, did we have one that was full? Maybe Duba at the end?
I don't remember. But, you know, and a lot of the guides now have babies.
I know, they have COVID babies.
Because they were all home for so long.
Well, we have a few COVID babies at Extraordinary Journeys too.
Oh, you do too. Yeah.
And Amber and Alan, how was it for you? Because South Africa, you know, they really got hit by bans and people not wanting to travel. So how was it for you when you were out there?
We were the first ones at everything that we did since they reopened, essentially, right?
Yeah. For our guides, like our guide in the Winelands, for example, we were his first tourists since the pandemic began.
Yeah.
So they were all, like Nancy and Ellen said, so excited to just have people there and wanted to share all their knowledge with us. And then in the safari camp, we were there for 4 nights. We had a couple nights with 4 or 5 people total, including us, and then 2 with just us. Yeah. So that was also amazing, but also weird to be like the only people that they were essentially open for. Everywhere we went, we were usually the only people or only had a handful of other people around us. So honestly, it felt very safe.
Yeah.
Because it was so spread out and we didn't really have much interaction with others other than our guides.
And how did that compare, for example, to going to Chile in January this year?
I guess it's different because Chile, by that point, you know, the vaccine and the boost had come out, and Chile was, I think, as a country, like 95% vaccinated. And so, they were still ultra careful. So we were all still wearing masks. So I think the biggest difference was that people were more comfortable being out. And with that widespread vaccination, they're even more comfortable, because I think when we were in South Africa, the vaccine hadn't hit South Africa yet.
Yeah, we had the 2 vaccines, but the booster hadn't come out or wasn't available yet. And then when we went, and they in South Africa didn't have the vaccine yet. They were just rolling it out when we were there. We saw the long lines for like the elderly.
Yeah,
that was it. So they were really jealous of us having the vaccine. Mm-hmm. but in
Chile it was different.
They all have the vaccine almost.
Yeah.
But
even then,
so it felt almost normal in that it was pretty busy, and a lot of our guides said it was almost returning back to normal levels for them.
Yeah. Already in January, because they opened Chile, just to give everyone some background, they didn't open till for foreigners till November of 2021. So by when we went there in January, they'd only opened for 2 months. So I'm surprised that already so many people were traveling.
Yeah, it was kind of surprising to us
too. Patagonia, when we're out there, like, for example, the trail that we were taking up Torres del Paine, we were told, we thought it was kind of crowded. We were told it's like lines and lines of people to get up the mountain. It wasn't that bad. We encountered pretty much a person every time. We're never alone on the trail. So it was certainly like, I would have expected it to be completely empty had we gone in May of 2021.
Well, you couldn't. you're
seeing a lot of tourists pretty quickly.
Yeah, that's interesting. Was it local tourists mostly, or from like
combination? There are some locals, but then a lot of Americans. Yeah.
Okay. Interesting. And was it, what were some, you know, kind of like the unexpected kind of, what was kind of unexpected? I mean, I know there was like a funny moment. I was talking to you, Nancy, last week, and you were telling me about a lion, maybe, like when you were, because you had, just to give background, Nancy and Ellen, they had to get multiple COVID tests during their trip because they were going from Zambia to Botswana. And this is a time when every time you crossed a border, you needed a new COVID test, essentially. So, yeah, well.
So we, it was our last full day at our last camp in Botswana, and we had to come home. And so the way they schedule it was for a nurse to come in a helicopter and meet you at a designated place in the bush. So we go to this place, and they had set up breakfast for us. And there was a tree and on a little bit of a mound. And there was the guy that was setting up was in his truck, and nobody understood what was going on, but there was a lion that came up and sat down in between the tree and the breakfast table and wasn't moving. So we went and drove around for a little while. They tried to scare the lion off. She got up, she walked around and went right back to the same place. And the helicopter comes, and we're all sitting watching the lion, but the nurse gets out of the helicopter, and our guide is like waving at him going, no, no, like lion, you know, and the guy ran back to the helicopter. The helicopter had to take off, move a couple hundred yards over there. And we went a couple hundred yards over there. He got attacked by bees and then gave us our PCR test. But we had our PCR test done, you know, and we were ready to leave when we had to.
Yeah, and those results, they were getting them pretty fast. I mean, that is something that I just found absolutely amazing, is how fast, I mean, in South Africa, you could get them at the airport, and like, I mean, where did Alan and where did you get your COVID test? I mean, they were so fast. You could get them pretty much anywhere at that point.
Yeah, so we were staying at the one and only in Cape Town as our last stop. And you guys had arranged for a nurse to come to our hotel room.
Yeah.
And we had...
But in Chile, we are the guides on the ground, or the tourist group, the locals over there helped us out. And we had a speakeasy COVID test, where it was in behind a truck in the middle of the parking garage at the airport, that you pay them cash and then they swab for you and have an instant result.
It was you just needed an antigen test. Yeah. So this guy was doing it out of his trunk. He had a busy schedule because people were lining up for that. So it was interesting.
Oh, that's really funny. I'm trying to think. I mean, we definitely had quite a few stories like that where sometimes we're like, okay, like, someone just show up and get this COVID test. especially in the beginning, it was a little crazy. What would you say, you know, were some of the challenges doing your travel that, you know, kind of made you nervous, and how did we help you get through those? And maybe you didn't, maybe you were very relaxed.
I think once we realized that it was going to happen, that we were going to go, you guys really do such a good job of communicating to us. Like, we had several calls before we went. We reviewed everything multiple times. You sent us packages. We printed our own stuff. We knew exactly what was going to happen when, who to call if there was an issue. And, you know, like, similar to the other trips that we've been on with you guys, you really take care of your travelers, and you send people away with confidence. So if anything, we had to be ready to pivot with airlines, because we were flying, the airline we were flying wasn't flying home from Johannesburg. So we ended up changing, my sister and I are big planners. So we weren't waiting to the last minute to try and change our flight home. So we ended up changing our flights. So we flew, a different route out of Johannesburg, in case it wasn't going to open up. It did open up, but we changed that. But you just had to be ready to, if not, yeah, you will go. But we were able to do it, and you guys made it really easy.
We were supposed to be on a small private charter from one camp to another, and the charter plane was, had a broken engine, and so we ended up flying through Lusaka, and it was a last minute, I think, change, but it was taken care of. It's just like you guys normally do. I mean, my biggest fear of traveling in COVID was that I was going to test positive when I got my test to leave. I was panicked that I was.
We were afraid we were going to test positive before we went.
Before,
not so much worried about coming home.
Yeah, I didn't care about coming home.
Yeah.
Was that the same for you, Alan Ever?
My biggest fear was testing positive to leave.
Yeah.
He was worried about testing positive to come home because he, I think, cares a little bit more about showing up to work than I do.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I just wanted to get there. That was my main goal.
Yeah, I think the only fears were trying to get there, because because of all the meetings we had with you guys, it was so well planned that I didn't really have any fear whatsoever. And once we got there, there was never a day where I thought, like, oh, if something went wrong, like, we'd be done, like, we'd be screwed. I felt completely confident the whole time.
Yeah.
I guess the hardest part is really just getting there. So, for example, when we were trying to fly to Johannesburg from Phoenix, we had several layovers, one of which was in Amsterdam, because the direct flight from Atlanta to Johannesburg was canceled. And so we had to go to Amsterdam and down. But the problem is that Amsterdam required all travelers to have a COVID test before arriving within a certain amount of time. But then Johannesburg had their own time frame too. So we had to do two subsequent COVID tests and time them perfectly according to what both airlines wanted and what both countries wanted in order to get in. So that was a little nerve-wracking, thinking that, well, what if we missed it by what if one of our flights is delayed, then we're out of the window for the how good this COVID test is. So that was the most stressful, but that's outside of what you guys did in the country once we were there.
Yeah, I mean, I was so impressed, especially for using your company for the first time.
Yeah.
In the middle of a pandemic, that every transfer was as planned and showed up, and yeah, you'd think like someone would get COVID or something would happen, but it was so smooth. And
everything that you guys wrote in the thing happened according to what it
okay.
We never had to worry.
But I think if we had to pivot and make different plans, all the people you guys had a contact on the ground already knew what to expect and what to do if something went wrong. So they already had their own contingency plans. Your contacts there are very good.
Yeah, no, we worked really hard, and I'm going to be very honest, it's not always easy, because sometimes, we don't always know, and we were talking to other, I know there's a lot of questions out there, what happens if I get COVID, and, we do the best we can. We always know we'll fight, we'll get what we'll, the best plan in action, but sometimes it's not always the answer people wanted, which would be you may be quarantined, or you may have to stay in a hotel room till you test negative. But we will make sure we will fight for you to get as many tests as you can, and we'll get you retested, and we will fight for you to get the best hotel. So it's not always what people want to hear, which is always difficult. So I guess my advice, what I was telling people, is if you have the flexibility, then you should go and bring a laptop with you. And if not, then that you may have to stay a few days somewhere. And as I mentioned, that never happened to us until Omicron, and we did have a few people, and you know, it actually ended up only the most they stayed was 5 nights. And we just made sure we brought them food. We had Uber Eats. We made it as comfortable as possible, but unfortunately there was just no way around it. You know, it's, you test positive for COVID and you kind of have to ride it out until, because the United States won't let you in, and there's just no way around that. And so sometimes we can pick the hotels. As I said, with Rwanda, we couldn't at first, but boy, did we fight. And did we get what we wanted at the end? And it worked out. But and that, you know, that person ended up loving their trip and never regretted going to Rwanda. But you know, it's always kind of a, we do the best we can to be on top of it. But like anything in travel, like there are things you just can't change. And so that's, you know, so I'm glad you went and you kind of were prepared for that, and you felt that we were prepared for that, because we certainly tried very, very, very hard, and we were trying to stay on top of it all the time. So what would you say to people? I mean, I think now it's changing, but what would you say? It sounds to me that you're glad you traveled and that you went. And what's your advice to people who, you know, things are changing, but what's kind of your advice for people who are trying to decide if it's still a good time for them to travel, if they should go or not? Any of you.
my advice is, if you want to go, you should go. You have to, you know, you have to figure out what your tolerance is for risk, and you know, and then minimize it. So you know, and that's what these guys are so good at. I mean, in terms of how many, you know, you don't want to have in-country PCR tests until you're ready to come home, then just go to one country and really see one country in depth. There are so many things that you can do that I don't think, you know, I said to Ellen, like, put your trust in the travel gods and in extraordinary journeys, and you should be fine. But I mean, I don't know if it's ever going to be the same as it was, or as easy as it was, but you know, if you want to go, you should go.
Without hesitation.
We had absolutely no issues.
But, you know, but also know, you have to, you know that this is a post-COVID world. We're still in a pandemic and things change. So you have to just plan on going. And if you have to change it, you change it, and you'll still end up going at some point.
Yeah.
I think flexibility is key. You just have to know that you can plan all you want, but things will change.
Mm-hmm.
Not as much anymore. But yeah, and you have to be prepared for that. But otherwise, I would just say book it and start looking forward to it.
Yeah,
because it'll happen.
I agree with Nancy. I mean, you know, this isn't going to go away. And if it does, it's not going to be anytime soon. And if you're looking to travel and kind of like what we were, we just wanted, it was a point of our lives that this is the perfect time for us to travel. So we decided to do it while minimizing or just listening to our own risk tolerance. So there wasn't a single time when I was there that I regretted it. I felt very safe, and I'm much, much more averse to taking risks than Amber is. And I felt pretty safe pretty much the entire way.
Wow. Well, I'm so glad you all made it. And I'm so glad you had great trips. I think you're absolutely correct. I think, and we will work, you know, we will never say do it if you're not comfortable. Like, I agree. Like, you have to go because you're flexible. You have to know the pros and the cons, and we'll work and try to assess, you know, I see faces here, and I've changed some trips because there were too many countries and we've had to kind of readjust it or not, or, you know, decide even the day of, if, you know, even a week before, sometimes we've changed the trips because the circumstances have changed. And it's interesting because right now we're seeing everything going backwards and like less and less COVID tests, but you know, in 3 months, something else may come up. We don't know what it's going to be like. We don't know what the summer will be like. And the camps will readjust as well, too, at that time. And that's what we're seeing with a lot of our partners on the ground and our suppliers is they readjust as things change as well. They are partners. We work together. So that's also kind of like good to know.
They've definitely been through it, too. And they want people to keep coming back. And I think that was really important when we planned our trip. We were really focused on what is the COVID cancellation or rescheduling clause that the camps are willing to make. And at the end, we ended up taking a country out of our last trip because it just made it too complicated to go to three instead of two. So instead of seeing the falls from the Zimbabwe and staying on the Zimbabwe side, we stayed in Zambia. And it was like almost last minute, a couple months before we left.
There you go. Yeah, absolutely. So, okay, well, it's already, you know, I know it's late, so I don't wanna keep everything up too late, but I do, so if you have any questions, I'm gonna answer some of the questions that were sent to me. If anyone has specific questions for Alan or Nancy or Amber and Alan, just, you know, type them out. But otherwise, I'm going to start answering some of the questions that were emailed to me this week. So Ellen, Nancy, Amber, Alan, thank you so much. I really appreciate you coming and sharing your experiences tonight.
Thank you. Our pleasure.
Okay. So I'm going to start with, I kind of just already talked about it a little earlier. The hardest question that everyone, that I do get a lot is what happens if I test positive for COVID? And I mentioned it earlier. Hopefully that will happen less and less as you do not have to get as many COVID tests. And it really, every country is very different. Some countries are allowing you to quarantine where you want. Some countries are making you, Rwanda being the strictest, where you have to quarantine in a government facility or government hotel that's been like approved by the government. But here's the trick with testing positive, and this is what we learned and we really tried doing, is you always kind of want to test where you're going to feel comfortable during your quarantine if you test positive. So for example, in the Seychelles, we would have people test in their hotels, because if they tested positive in their hotels, they could quarantine in their hotels. If I tested them at the airport and they tested positive in the airport, then I kind of was stuck and had to use whatever government at the airport was telling me to quarantine people. So these are kind of little tricks we started learning about quarantine as you know, we try as much as we can. In South Africa, we have a little bit more flexibility, so it's not as important, but we started kind of knowing where these where you wanted to start, you know, just by talking to fellow travelers. And we're always talking to a lot of people in the industry. So sometimes they do have to fly you back. Some places like Botswana, they could fly you back to Mon. But again, thankfully, like they seems to be less and less of a problem. People are more and more comfortable with you being able to quarantine where you want. And following up that question, someone was asking me, well, what about those costs? Like who's paying for those quarantine hotels and what happens? And you know, unfortunately, this is, again, some of the answers no one likes to hear. Unfortunately, the travel insurance, they have very strict budgets, like what they'll pay for your quarantine if you get travel insurance, for example. So I think it's about like $400 or $500 is what they'll cover. And the rest is kind of out of pocket. But you will have to, and I see Rachel's kind of nodding her head because she's our travel insurance specialist. The good news is a lot of places will negotiate a special rate. So we're able to get much lower rates for people who want to quarantine. And so we were able to keep it down and not, you know, no one paid excessive amounts during that time. Like I think the Intercontinental in Johannesburg, some people stayed there, not my clients, but I heard of people and they were giving, the rooms were like 150 a night, you know, so nothing, you know, so yes, insurance would cover some of it. And then if you interrupted your trip and you had travel insurance, the part that was interrupted covered by insurance, you would get your money back for that. We looked at other solutions. There was for a moment an insurance that claimed that if you tested positive, they would fly you back. I think it had good intent. They tried to, it's just the numbers never made sense. And at the end of the day, they kept on stalling the evacuation flights and no one got evacuated. I think it was, so it just ended up, we just kept on saying, don't buy that anymore and just stick with like, be ready to pay out of pocket and we'll find a place that's not too expensive where you can ride it out. And you know, everyone was helpful. Like if people needed computers, we could get computers. We'll make it as comfortable as possible. As I said, in the person in Rwanda, they ended up having a pool and a villa and everything. It worked out great. And they had a great time. They didn't want to leave the hotel and they were very happy to quarantine out there. So it all worked out. So hopefully, I think Alejandro, that was your question about costs. COVID testing, there's a lot of questions about the COVID tests. Every country again is different. You know, the toughest one is probably Tanzania, where the government has to do the COVID tests, and you're kind of now it's probably something I shouldn't say on camera, but I bet they put whatever you want on that COVID test results. It's awful. I shouldn't be saying it. All the other countries are probably doing it correctly. I'm not sure. In Tanzania is basically, when are you leaving the country? When do you want the test to say what date on it? It is what it is. Like I didn't make the rules. but all the other countries, you know, was pretty easy to get COVID tests. They're all around. Botswana was the most expensive because we always had to fly someone to meet people in the middle of nowhere. So the most expensive part of Botswana was flying in a technician in a helicopter, as you experience in Botswana, Nancy and Ellen. But nowadays, there's very few countries. The only country that's left right now in Africa, at least, and even in South America is changing, where they're requiring COVID tests, are it's really just Zimbabwe right now, Rwanda and Uganda, I think. Am I missing another country? I think that's it. Those are the only places where you need, and then you only need a COVID test to come back into United States. The United States does require you to have an antigen test home, and it's required to get that test within a calendar day of your departure. And what we found is that you can travel with tests. There's this test called EMED, for example, that you can do with a virtual doctor. And we did it a few times for clients if it was hard to get a COVID test, and that worked really well. So as I said, all of this is getting pretty easy. Rachel, I'm going back to my notes. There were some more questions also, travel insurance. Again, that kept on coming up. Can you tell us, what does travel insurance cover? And what are you covered for COVID?
So you are covered for COVID only if you were to get it. So for sickness, you know, sickness, injury, that's always going to be included in a comprehensive policy. You know, you're not covered for, you know, fear of COVID. You're not covered if borders close, flights are grounded, travel bans, those things. And I think that comes as a surprise to a lot of people, are not covered. You know, there's a clause with some policies called cancel for any reason. It's become more popular since COVID. You know, it's just something you can add right when you get insurance. It's like an early purchase benefit. It's quite expensive, and you know, that one only gets you 50 to 75% back. But you know, as far as COVID and what's covered, really only if you get it, before your trip or on the ground. And like Elizabeth said, you know, you would have coverage for, you know, everything that you insured that you didn't get to experience. So when you got back, you could do a claim, and that's insurance wide. And what I've noticed is a lot of companies will claim, you know, that they have COVID coverage included. You know, you compare policies on different sites, and then when I go into it, I look at the fine print. They're just calling COVID coverage the fact that they cover if you get it. So there's really not an insurance company that has anything special or you know, more significant than others. So,
and you know, and I can talk by experience, like people who did test positive before, and you know, we did have a few people test positive before their trips, and if they had travel insurance, you did see the claims go through and they did get their money back on their trips.
Yeah, every time. I don't like to say never, but I've never seen Travel Guard at least deny a claim, because we partner with Travel Guard. So, you know, as long as you follow exactly what the policy says, you know, I find their fine print really straightforward. And yeah, so I think prior to COVID, we used to really just encourage making sure that everybody had, you know, emergency medical evacuation insurance. But these days, definitely our recommendation is a comprehensive policy.
just in case, because we've seen so many more people get COVID even before their trips. I mean,
and yeah, and
yeah, go ahead, Rachel.
Yeah, really just for that reason, you know, the getting it beforehand, it's no matter what, no matter where you're going, you need it to exit the US for your trip. So because no matter what, somebody's going to need it. Yeah. Now, you know, we'll start to, depending on, you know, how many countries they're going to, if they even need to take a test on the ground, you know, maybe it's not something that we would encourage as much, but yeah.
And medical evacuation, just so everyone knows, it's only going to, you know, they'll take you to the hospital. Like, let's say you did get COVID on the ground and you're not sick, basic, they'll make you quarantine in your hotel room, or they're not going to evacuate you back to the United States because you have COVID. The only case is if you got really, really, really sick, they may decide you have to be evacuated. But most likely, you know, if you were to get sick, they would first either have you be treated, you know, wherever the doctor says to be treated, or to a hospital, if there were, you know, if that's what they thought, or if the hospitals were full or they really need you to be evacuated, they would evacuate you. But knock on wood, I mean, we haven't had to test it. I hope we never have to. We've had to test medical evacuations for other reasons, like, you know, we've had in the past people break a leg or something where we've had to use it, but not for COVID. And it works. Someone was asking about insurance in Mexico. And unfortunately, we only know, you know, every country insurance is so strict and really depends. Even in the United States, it's by state, even. Like New York has a different underwriter than like a different, you know, than Washington, than Arizona. So it's just for Mexico, it has to be like a local, and we're not licensed to do anything in Mexico. So if anyone lives in Mexico, unfortunately, we can only give advice or help with travel insurance in the United States and for residents in the United States. Let me see. Is there a few other questions were about safety, if it was safer to travel to one country or another. Honestly, you know, on safari, you're out, you're in the fresh air, the vehicles are open, the camps are open. I don't know if anyone wants to, like, anyone on the team has an opinion about this. I mean, the one country that I would say, from the feedback, I didn't go, was maybe Egypt was less safe, because it really sounded like when Gina and Lisa came back, they were like, oh, there's no COVID in Egypt. Like, they could not be less careful in Egypt, and there were huge groups and people traveling. So I would say on safari, I don't feel like it's very different that one country would be safer than another. Does anyone have a strong opinion on the team? I see Laura nodding, or...
I agree. I think when you're on safari between countries, I don't think that there's a big safety issue at all. I don't know about Egypt because I wasn't there, but it did sound like a bit of a free-for-all. So, yeah.
So, and otherwise, in terms of cities, Nairobi versus Cape Town and other places, you know, I see Rita, poor Rita is on the call. She's in Cape Town, so it's probably 3 a.m. for her. But you know, they're just taking off the masks now, I think. But they've been all pretty careful. And I even say Nairobi, and Nairobi is a city where people are outdoors a lot. So I would say it's pretty safe overall. I wouldn't say, you know, you don't spend that many time. You spend a lot of time outdoors when you're in Africa. So, it really, I would say it all is pretty equal. Flying, there were questions about flights and how were the flight schedules now. They seem to be settling down a little more. My advice, and again, if anyone on the team disagrees with me, what was really interesting, especially for South Africa, is even when they had the travel ban, all the US airlines were guaranteeing you would go back to United States. So there was never a real travel ban. They called it a travel ban, but if you're on United Airlines or on Delta, as long as you weren't traveling through Europe on those flights, they made it really easy, actually, and they never canceled flights. If anything, they've added now more flights to South Africa. United Airlines just announced they were going to do a direct flight from Washington, D.C. to Cape Town. So they're feeling optimistic. So I would say they are looking pretty good right now. The airlines that were great during COVID were probably Qatar for us, and Delta and United. I'd say some that were a little bit more difficult were British Airways, probably because of the UK restrictions, sometimes KLM because of their restrictions. Everything through Europe had ups and downs because of the country's restrictions, the rules in Europe. But Nairobi, Kenya has a direct airline, has a direct flight. That was pretty easy. And there was a direct flight to Southern Africa. That was pretty easy. Alicia, are there any questions that you see that came in on the chat that I missed or?
We have about 10 questions. So our team's been kind of on standby ready to answer them, but the first three are kind of all similar. There was a question from Stephanie about, does Kenya require PCR tests? And then from Janice, does South Africa require a PCR test? And from David, does Botswana all? The answer for all of those is Botswana, South Africa, Namibia, Zambia, and Kenya, and Tanzania no longer require a test.
If you're vaccinated.
If you're vaccinated. Yeah.
Does Botswana ask for the test still? Does Botswana?
No, if you're vaccinated. So if you have three, you need to have two shots and the booster.
Just two now?
See, it changes every minute. Thank you, Rachel. You know, last time I saw, they asked for the booster. Now they don't require the booster. Okay, so if you have your two shots for Botswana, you do not need a PCR test.
That helps porque that's a limited for to travel, you know.
I saw that somebody had asked about needing it to exit. So, you know, you don't know if you don't need a PCR, no, but you know, if you're moving from country to country, a lot of them, it just depends on, you know, if the next destination you need it. So you always have to adhere to that. But also it sounds like Zimbabwe.
You cut out.
Stops their PCR.
Can you say that again, Zimbabwe what?
Oh, it looks like they finally just dropped the PCR test. We were kind of waiting on that.
Another question was from Tiffany, is there an alcohol ban in Tanzania? Our team says the only alcohol bans were during the pandemic and those are no more. Does anybody want to elaborate on that?
I'd say the only countries that had an alcohol ban, and correct me if I'm wrong, if anyone remembers it differently, I think it was just South Africa for a while and Botswana. I don't think any other country ever had an alcohol ban.
And then there was a question from Alejandra specifically for Nancy. She said, how did Extraordinary Journeys really help you during COVID? You mentioned the story of the lions and the bees, but how do I know EJ has my back? And if I get COVID on the trip, how can EJ help? So I guess that's a two-tiered answer.
Oh, wow, Nancy.
I think, Nancy, really, if you can answer my, because I've been waiting this pandemic from Mexico City and it's like, I have to trust somebody. So Nancy, please share with me.
Well, they make themselves available if there is a problem and they help you solve it. I mean, Ellen, you can tell your story about Chile. It had nothing to do with COVID, but Ellen, we were supposed to meet in Santiago and she missed her connection in Miami. And there was, if she was gonna miss the flight, she would have missed the first 3 days of the trip in Torres del Paine. And we contacted all of the
anyone folks who would listen at Extraordinary Journeys. So yeah, we don't remember who it was. We got a human, we women alone,
because I'm traveling alone, I need for somebody to really help me, you know.
But they did. They had someone met her at her gate, ran her through the airport. She made it. Her luggage didn't make it.
They picked up my luggage and saved it for when we were swinging back through Santiago.
You can't be in better hands. I just can't understate it. That every time there's an issue, it's not that often that happens. But when you need them, they're there. They can't guarantee
that you won't get COVID. But if you do,
of course, nobody. But just to feel protected, you know, in these crazy times, because it's still COVID. It's very important being alone and how to solve the flight and the bands and everything. It's just crazy.
Also had an answer from Laura on our team. She just has some background noise. So I'll read it. She said, we support you by working with our partners on the ground to make sure you have access to multiple tests. And we work with clients to be sure you're comfortable. and in the best hotel situation? Maybe Elizabeth or someone else maybe wants to elaborate.
Yeah, I would say like we have some Mindery, we'll have partners in each country. Like we always have a network in every country. So even if it's not someone that's directly hired by a company, these are people we've worked with for a very long time that we're able to call and like come in and help at any moment. So even when someone did test positive for COVID, they were never alone. We always made sure someone even was just contacting them, telling them what was going on, making sure, like I said, it was little things like they got tired of eating the same food at the hotel and we made sure we had Uber Eats. It's nothing. It's not, you know, but it's little things like making sure that you had a number to call at all times and ask, you know, what's going on? What can I do? Is anyone contacting the airlines? And that's what we've developed as a network of very trustworthy people that we can reach out to at any moment. And just say, hey, you need to step in now and help.
And then we had another question from Tom and Sherry, and it was, what is tourism volume looking like right now in Eastern Africa? Are all the previous postponements and cancellations now booked for travel? Laura also said to that 2022 in East Africa is very busy, starting in June to October. It's probably going to feel back to about 2019 volumes.
Yeah, I mean, I look at July and August as we're back to like, it's going to be a very busy summer and it's great. We're excited. But it's definitely kind of like coming back, and the number of inquiries we're getting and the number of people wanting to travel right now. I mean, we are back to 2019. So right now in the next 2 months is probably still the quietest because people are still kind of like getting back on their feet. But it's definitely starting to pick up for sure.
And then from Linda and Dawn, should we bring our own COVID test kits? Our team says EMED tests work in some countries to be used as an antigen test for re-entry into the US, but it's not every country. So work with your safari specialist on your exact situation.
Yeah, there are a few countries that they're saying will not allow you to use them. One of them is Tanzania for some reason, but otherwise, you should bring it just in case. There's no harm in bringing it. We definitely think it's not a bad idea. But it is quite easy to organize antigen tests also on the ground.
And then we had another question from Rebecca Scott. It was, I just got the Johnson & Johnson shot. Will the one shot plus a booster be considered fully vaccinated in South Africa, Botswana, Zimbabwe?
The one shot on its own without the booster at present is enough. So fully vaccinated is two doses, you know, Moderna, Pfizer, one J&J right now. There, Botswana did come out and say, you know, booster. So for maybe 2 weeks, that was the case, but they took it back. So also to add on to, you know, I think the value in working with us and, you know, I think you've just been able to see it even with our back and forth, these requirements are constantly changing, but, you know, my team in operations, we keep a very close eye on it and are just really meticulous about checking the requirements, making sure that, you know, just because an article comes out, we often find it's not correct. So I feel like we've really established a good network of who, you know, who we can absolutely trust as the final word. And so, yeah.
But can you help with Mexico? So you can help me travel?
With COVID requirements, yeah, we'll always look that up. Not all of our clients, you know, live in the United States. So as far as just outlining what they need to have, yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
I think that's all the questions on this list. There was one other question about how many antigen tests specifically they should bring, but I think we addressed that.
I mean, I would only bring, I mean, just the ones to, I mean, I guess as many as you, I mean, it's a hard question, like hopefully just one to get you back to the US. But then I thought about it. I was like, well, what if you do test positive, then have another one ready. So maybe four, you know, I don't know. It's a hard question. I would say probably two. Some people take two with them just in case, because there are some false positives. They seem to be much better now. There are a lot more false positives, I think, in the beginning. I haven't seen that happen as much anymore.
And that's all the questions in the chat so far.
Okay, well, I think that's it. I think we hopefully covered a lot of questions and, you know, kind of gave a good sense of what it's like and kind of made you hopefully more comfortable to kind of go if you are ready, and if not, not go. but we're prepared, we're here to help. And if we didn't answer anything, you know, if we missed something today or something comes up and you think of something, you know, we're always available and reach out to us. You know, the whole team is here, and we're always learning something new. We always are looking for solutions. Like, we've got our heads on our shoulders and we really like to think through things. So we'll find the answers.
One last question. I think this has a varied answer, but to go on Extraordinary Journeys trip, do we need to be vaccinated and boosted? I think the answer to that is it depends on the specific country.
Yeah. We don't do group trips. So, you know, it is kind of at your, you know, we follow the protocols of the countries of where you go, and you got to follow that at this, you know, it's a lot of back and forth on this. It's a hard question. You know, if we were doing groups, we'd probably ask everyone within the groups. But at this point, we are following the protocols of the countries of where you're going. So if they require it, you're required. So. Okay. well, everyone, I hope that was a fun evening. Thank you so much for joining us. And I will hopefully get to talk to all of you soon again. Thank you, everyone. Bye.